What's up, people? Welcome back to Shed Show. Thank you so much for joining me. We have an extremely special guest this episode. And, let's give him a call. See if he answers. Hello. Welcome to Shed Show, a place where we introduce ourselves.
Thank you. My name's Thomas Morton. Do I tell you what? I'm Thomas, yeah.
Yeah, you can...
That's what I got for you right now, yeah.
Thomas has been, as I'm sure all of you are aware, in more video stuff from Vice than maybe anyone else, and definitely my favorite, and I think most people's favorite Vice correspondent. And I really am not just... I'm not just saying that to fluff your ego. I guarantee if there was a national poll...
It does fluff.
It would be you. What everyone, including myself, is wondering is what happened with you and Vice. Apparently, You all parted ways in 2019, and I am dying to know what happened.
I wish it was more interesting. There were layoffs. Like, I wish I could remember the amount of people who got laid off with me, but it was a bunch of us. Like, to this day, I know a bunch of people I worked with for years got fired at the same time, but I have no idea, you know, the comprehensive axing list.
Do you have any idea what the criteria was for their choices?
I don't, but it was a lot of people who were, there were a lot of producers I'd worked with and who had, been at the company for a while, done like amazing work for them. It was really good folks. It was folks I would have assumed were, you know, kind of secure in their place at the company, and that it would have been foolish of the company to get rid of at the time they did. But who knows? Maybe our pitiful salaries were weighing down the end of the payroll. Maybe we were the 1% of the company.
I did read somewhere that you're worth $4 million.
Whoa. Who said that? And how do I get that money?
Did anyone at Vice, when you were laid off, have a face-to-face with you?
No, done by phone, via a stranger by phone in the rich tradition of American business culture.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but if you guys don't know, Thomas started at Vice in 2004 as an intern. That's 15 years.
That is 15 years, yeah.
That is 15 years, literally more assignments than I could count. I don't understand how they can just casually lay someone off like that. It makes no sense.
That's how layoffs work. It's how, as said, it was all done according to a kind of standard operating procedure. Any gripes I had at the time were met with, you know, and not from them, like from, you know, friends of mine, colleagues and stuff like that, who, you know, were otherwise commiserating, who were just like, yeah, that's just what they do in business. And it's in, like, as said, I was there for 15 years, which puts me at about 20 when I started as an intern. So I've just, like, from a totally privileged position, I had one job for 15 years. And so I never went through that. But that's what, like, that's what firing is. It's like, you know, I don't know. There's something about it with America that just the devastating, the way we talk about it in such a casual sense, about getting someone fired, or, you know, getting fired yourself or whatever. And the effect it has on your job, like on your life, especially after you've been someplace for a while, like is rough. And it's not just, like, it certainly wasn't just the company, and it's not just the industry. It's a whole cultural thing, yeah.
I hear what you're saying, but I'm very, like, hesitant to consider your case, like, just sort of boilerplate. I mean, I feel it doesn't even make sense because everybody loves to watch your shit. I don't understand from a business standpoint. You were extremely prolific.
I had a good run, yeah.
I don't...
There was a major shift in the office, like, over the last few years before I got laid off. There was, you know, editorially, there was a shift, kind of like this kind of ongoing shift towards, like, news versus what I'd call, like, you know, maybe cultural reportage or more classic documentary style?
As far as we can tell, they haven't changed at all. They're literally still releasing your stuff.
Well, they give them new names. They retitled them, which drives me up the wall.
So this is, I'm sure not all of them, but just for the audience, I'm just gonna read off some of the places that you've been, because I mean, it's insane. Okay. I'm just gonna go through Alaskan wilderness, Colombia, middle of the ocean, Uganda, Republic of Congo, Ghana, Czech Republic.
DRC, I think.
Okay.
I won't interrupt. Czech Republic, South Korea.
China, many times, many different places. Mauritania, uh-huh. Indonesia, Chirac, yep. Panama, Syria, Israel, West Africa, Togo, Lagos, Togo.
Yep. Togo is the country, yeah, and then Lagos is in Nigeria.
Okay.
The big city.
Kyrgyzstan.
Then Kyrgyzstan, yep. And then the third K, Kazakhstan.
Oh, Kazakhstan, okay. Senegal, Dakar. But yeah, that's just some of these places. This was some really heavy stuff. I mean, in Colombia, the homeless, you know, basically living in sewers and having to hide from death squads all the time.
Yeah.
So Thomas, I'm having a really hard time gauging your feelings about leaving Vice, because it seems like maybe you're just the type of person that just takes things in stride. And obviously it was 2 years ago at this point, but I mean, do you wish you were there?
Yeah, if you had talked to me 2 years ago, I might be a little more, I might be a little more reticent to talk about it just because of how recent it was, knowing folks are still there. At the time, just given kind of the atmosphere in the office, it was, had it not been kind of like a surprise layoff, and with all the kind of like attendant corporate bullshit that goes with that, it wouldn't have been a bad time to go off and explore other things. So I'm, you know, it was, it's weird though. It's like, I don't know if you've done anything kind of continually for 15 years. The common comparison among people that I associate, you know, who I know from Vice and who I worked with for years was like, you know, it was one of those jokes that's just like, that just isn't even that funny on account of its truth, but it was like, you know, either you could either call it like a family or a cult, you know? We're all working together. Like, we're all there. Nobody was there to advance, you know, in the earlier days, to advance their professional career or for the money, because neither of those, that was not what Vice was for. And so everybody was kind of there on a, usually a similar creative wavelength. They were there to pursue, you know, the creative side of whatever they were doing. And they were there, you know, also in large part because we all liked each other, and we'd spend all our time together working, and then we'd go out to the bars together. Like, these are, you know, some of my close friends. So it's a weird thing to parse, you know?
Yeah.
And it wasn't just a job, and it's like, and you know, through my limited attempts at working in the outside world of like print media and video stuff, it worked very differently. And a lot more loosely for most of, or at least for most of when I was there, than the rest of the world works. So it's weird, yeah. And I'm not just trying to be like circumspect or political about this, or polite. I miss being there in 2011. I also miss being whatever I was, 27. I don't know if I'd be there right now. Like, it was probably a good time to consider a change of scenery.
Were you burnt out on the traveling and the assignments and stuff?
Yeah, probably. I mean, that kind of all kicked in a little after. It's easy, and you know, I could probably already start feeling it being less easy to kind of, when you have a momentum to kind of just keep going and bouncing. But there was a lot of it like stacked on just, you know, trip after trip after trip working on things, which is always, I don't know, like, especially having come from like, I always considered making video stuff this kind of, like, weird sideline.
Right.
That I, you know, just almost, you know, like a weird bonus thing I got to do, because I'd primarily think of, you know, my job there as writing and editing for the magazine, even though, like, I haven't, you know, by 2012, I think I wasn't even doing that at all. It was the video stuff was completely 100% of my time spent there, but it never, you know, it was, I don't know, you travel with people that you like, you cover stories you're interested in, you get to go do things that you wouldn't just be able to walk into a country and go ask the person, you know, to come see or right. to show you. So it's fun.
These crazy assignments you were always going on, I mean, it seems like you wouldn't be able to find that kind of gig anywhere else. I mean, who else?
It was, or have it find me. I feel like I can barely take responsibility for ending up in front of the camera. It was almost like a weird accident. It's like, and I mean, probably sound a little vainglorious to compare it to like whatever National Lampoon or Spy magazine, but it was a unique culture. And you know, I feel like for the times I stood by and loved it, like a unique cultural product that, you know, maybe there'll be a next one, a successor to it, you know, in this like the younger generation right now or in 15 years or something like that. But it really was like a weird, you know, being in the right place sort of gig.
Right. I've heard you describe it as, what did you say, winning the lottery.
Yeah.
And then you followed that up with an anecdote that people who win the lottery always go bankrupt.
Yeah, I was like, I think that's like a specious statistic, but yeah, it's like that 100% of people who've won a certain amount in the lottery, yeah. That's a nice plume of vapor rolling off your head.
What's up?
Oh, I said there was a nice plume of vapor rolling off your head, like mist lifting off the Blue Ridge Mountains.
Oh, wow. So you said you feel like the Ringo Starr of Vice.
When did I say that?
You said it, man. I don't have the exact date or timestamp, but you said it. And
I like that.
Basically, you were saying that when the Beatles broke up, everybody went and did their own thing, and like you were saying like, I just want to get the band back together and just, you know.
That's it, yeah. Like Ringo, who even as an amazing drummer, which I hope is unquestionable by this point, was always, you know, is always the fourth man out in terms of like, you know, the songwriting and musical talent of the others. But he was like the most Beatle of the Beatles. Like he was the one who was into it. And I'm forever trying to get my version of the band back together. It's like in the last year, I was trying to think if I did more than one video project, but I'm pretty sure it was just one. And I immediately went to the people I used to work with at Vice. And when I was making the TV show Balls Deep, I had a really tight-knit, an amazing crew who were dedicated staff mm-hmm. to the show.
You want something like that again?
Yeah, there was, yeah. Oh, of course, I'd live for that. That was the, when work feels like some sort of weird productive art project you're doing with your friends, when you're getting paid to do something like that, it felt like, all my metaphors are related to like music and bands, just because like I grew up as a weird little indie rock kid, or not that weird, just a regular fucking indie rock kid. When it was good, it felt like being in a band, you know, versus working at a company.
How have your efforts so far gone in trying to get yourself a band back together?
It ain't gone so great. It's hard to move on from a place that, like, you know, want to call it a creative endeavor versus a company, where it feels like you've won the lottery, like, and have worked for years just solely on projects that you're interested in with people
yeah.
you like being around and whose ideas you trust, you know?
This is my issue with that comparison, where you say you won the lottery, right? Because you started as an intern. That's probably the most genuine way to even start with a company. And then you became this hyper contributor to the company. Your content is undoubtedly some of the most popular content that Vice has ever made, and undoubtedly a big reason for their success. You know that, you know what I mean? That's different from winning the lottery.
I get what you're saying, yeah.
You earned it all. I mean, you did all the work.
I hope the work that I did do a lot of work, and I hope it was good work.
It's fucking great work, dude.
Well, thank you, I appreciate that. Like, when I took that internship, I was looking for something to do that summer. I was not, and it was like, and I was excited to get a chance, you know, to stay in the city and not have to go like take a depressing ass job.
Was Vice anything at that point in 2004?
It was. It was a very popular but like kind of minimally distributed. It was the magazine, and I'd been reading it for like 3 or 4 years, and loved it.
So you chose it.
Well, yeah, and I chose it, to have something to do that summer, and I was excited. And I, you know, and they weren't the only people I applied for an internship to, but when they accepted me, I was psyched. It was the one I wanted to do, you know, and I didn't walk in assuming like that I'd even get a chance to write there, you know? I was like, cool. So for whatever, you know, whatever pretense of humility I operate under, the fact that company became the company that it was and that I had the opportunity to stay there, and to hop without applying myself to do any sort of like on camera broadcast stuff, like that's, yeah, you know, that was being like insanely fortunate to be in the right place at the right time with the right people. Even part of being, you know, part of feeling like I won the lottery was like the people I was working with were pretty much like the writers and magazine editors that I like looked up to most, that I still consider mentors and role models. And we'd hang out, like it was, yeah.
Yeah, basically you never wanted to be on camera. That's not the type of stuff you were ever imagining yourself doing, right?
Not really, no, I didn't.
They basically put you in front of the camera and they could see that it worked, I think, right?
Yeah, that's basically what happened. It felt like there was a sense, and I think the way we, like, I don't know, the way I've talked about it, like, publicly or whatever, is that there was a sense that it was, like, kind of, like, almost like this weird prank.
Right.
Just in that I was, in especially at the time, it was a very unkempt 20-whatever-year-old, you know. And, still am extremely dandruffy and just, like, bad. Bad with presentation. But, yeah, and you know, and the first video I did for them was a remarkable fuck up in terms of what the plan was and what we actually shot, which like I learned as a kind of like became almost like a dictum for how to operate in the field. It's just like assume, make plans, but assume. Don't just assume some of the plans won't work and be adaptable. It's like assume everything is gonna go the fuck wrong on your shoot. I went down there assuming, it was like, look, I'll give this a shot, but like I can see, you know, a month ahead from now, it's just gonna be an edit where I'm removed completely from it. And then I get to go back to the editorial warden of the magazine, right, and do my little typeety typeety type stuff, you know, and be happy.
So like, are you gonna miss just doing these random crazy things, or are you kind of like done?
For sure, with the alacrity and like lack of oversight that we used to do it. I mean, we would, you know, I'm trying to remember the shortest turnaround between a story idea and going out in the field. But there's definitely times I got off a plane, made it home, and got on another plane for a story that, you know, like I'd talked about with a producer like maybe a couple weeks before. You know, I have made peace with the fact that that's never gonna happen again. I had a fucking tremendous run though. The type of traveling we did kind of spoils you for any sort of conventional traveling. Cause you know, you go first of all to places that like are in general very off the beaten path, just in terms of the regions you're in. People just allow you crazy access and to intimate aspects of their lives, into like criminal enterprises and things like that. The doors are open to try anything you want.
You never intended on doing stuff like that, but would you like to get a job where you're in front of the camera covering stories again? And
oh, hell yeah. No, it's like it doesn't feel like work, you know? It's the fun part of writing a story. It's getting to go out and meet people and ask questions and build up, you know, take your notes and build the research. And then, you know, from there, you go sit in your room for 3 days and try not to kill yourself as you write the thing.
For this episode, we're just gonna make sure we got you leaving Vice covered, which I think we did.
Yeah, sorry, I wish it was a more spectacular story. I wish I had like flamed out on drugs or like punched somebody or something like that, because there are a few of those in the Vice Family Chronicles that were glorious. But it was your run-of-the-mill firing, you know? And it wasn't even me alone. Like, I can't even be like, oh, well, it was because... Oh, you know what I like to say, though? I'd gotten the very last story I tried to do that never aired, because I got in a fight with the guy who was running the news department over a very particular matter. I'd gotten the opportunity to spend like 2 full days in New York just hanging out with John Lydon, Johnny fucking Rotten, who was the like the nicest, most gracious, most fun person I had ever met. In addition to being like one of
a legend,
my musical heroes, yeah, and like an intellectual hero, I would toss out. So he had he's like in his 60s. He'd put on a little bit of weight, and we got in this crazy argument about whether or not, like, I was given a note that was like, we need to address his weight. And I was like, what? I was like, why the fuck would we do that? That's fucking rude, first of all. And it became this weird dispute where it's like, I found him making fun of his own weight in, you know, over the course of hanging out. And I was like, here, he could say it. If he says it and he's making fun of himself, then that's like, I'm fine with that, first of all. Like, I think that's totally cool. I was like, me saying something in voiceover is like, it's like, I don't feel good about that. And I don't think it's good. I think it's a really fucked up thing. And this became this weird, like, it held, like, you know, this thing was almost through being edited. It was supposed to get turned, like, put online pretty quickly and stuff like that. And it dragged on for weeks, this weird feud over whether or not to comment on his weight. I was like, fuck, if this was like, first of all, this was a fucking female like musician, this would be like these emails would be like things that get people fired. So that was the last thing I did before the layoffs. I like to think that the reason I was fired was for not making a fat joke about Johnny Rotten.
The person that you had this dispute with, was it someone that you had been working with already on other stuff, or I don't know if you want to even reveal.
Let's call him upper management.
What was this person's reasoning behind this?
Their deal? I couldn't wager to guess. It was such a like.
It almost seems like they made a note that's just fucking stupid, and then maybe just stuck to it just out of ego or something, because I don't understand that. It makes no sense.
It's possible. And I was like, that guy was a treat to us. And John Lydon does not have the best reputation with, in terms of being pleasant with the press. Like, he fucking rolled out the carpet. Like, he was a sweetheart. He was the, like, anyway, yeah, so.
So this person who gave this note was completely in the wrong. When did this happen in relation to you getting laid off? Fuck. You said it was the last thing, but it didn't get aired.
Yeah. It was a couple months before. There was like this long leeway where I was working on written shit. Yeah, it was the last video thing I did.
That's
yeah.
The scoop I was looking for.
There you go. Well, it's a better story too than in terms of just personal narrative. Then it was like, yeah, there was a whole bunch of layoffs, and for the most part, got canned.
I honestly, it
Might be true, too. Who knows? It sounds it, doesn't it?
Does it make sense that a 15-year veteran who is one of the faces of the most viewed content that they ever made, does it make sense that you would just get caught up in a little budget thing where there's layoffs? That doesn't make sense.
It's what happens.
No. Do you get any royalties or anything?
No. None whatsoever. I should have been a lot smarter about things, but, you know. It was a very handshake kind of place for a long time, and I sort of rode that longer than I should have.
I've been all up in the comment sections, and I know that there's a lot of people that love your shit, and a lot of people that are just coming to find out that you were let go from Vice, and they don't know why. It doesn't make sense. It's like, this is one of the best parts of this thing. Why would that happen? So, you know, I know that there's people that want to know, and I really appreciate you bringing it to me. And I'm going to get my emotions in check.
It's okay. You know what? It's like anytime, like just because I, you know, just because I did things that got on TV or like video and stuff like that, and it, you know, it just horrible fucking rupture through my life, totally out of whack, and my finances extremely. But anytime this happens across America, for like, you know, it's like it has a very similar impact on people. People's jobs are, you know, tantamount to their existence oftentimes. And you know, I'm a privileged fucking example of that. Like this disaster, like my problems are, you know, they're first world problems, as we like to say. And they're very white collar professional first world problems on top of that. But it's a fucked up culture, and it's like, and I, you know, I've directly experienced a very mild, in the scheme of things, and very fortunate variation of the, you know, the life destroying firing kind of scenario, which I don't like, but it helps. I don't know. I in terms of what it's done since it happened, it just galvanized what I should have felt more strongly about the whole time, about just in general the culture of corporate commerce in our fucked country.
So next time, let's talk a little bit about our fucked up country. And I also want
to
talk about
what's
next for you. And it's an honor and a pleasure to have you on. Thank you so much. And thank you guys for joining us. And that's all I got for now.
Peace.